The Apostle Paul, apart from Jesus, is the most important man in the history of Christianity. And through the ages, Paul has been a controversial figure for the church. Even today, people debate if Paul was the real deal, if we should listen to Paul's voice. I brought an article from the Sydney Morning Herald about 2 years ago. It's written about the Apostle Paul. It'll come up on the screen. The title is "Let Philau Follow St. Paul's Teachings on Gays and Let Us Find Them Ridiculous." And in the article, we find St. Paul happens to be the principal architect of the Christian belief system, notwithstanding Jesus, the good guy himself. And the article goes on, "The Bible, in all its muddled, wonderful, and sometimes cruel teachings, is relied upon to challenge today's freedoms. And these days we take Paul's epistles containing many vicious attacks with a pinch of salt, extracting from it the wonderful messages of love and park the other bits. Paul is a muddled, wonderful, cruel man to be taken with a grain of salt. And he's often held up against Jesus." This author of this article says that Paul is angry and harsh, and his teachings overwhelm the voice of Jesus, who is loving and kind and inclusive. See, Paul is very often under attack, even today, in our world. I met someone from our church not too long ago. We were having coffee, and they said to me, "We should disregard the writings of Paul. We should focus on the words of Jesus. Paul drifted away from the truth," they said. So this kind of questioning of Paul, when we read Galatians, we see it's not new. Back in 50 AD, the time of this letter, Paul faced these same kind of challenges. Back then, like today, some people really didn't like Paul's teaching, and so they didn't like Paul. They challenged him. They tried to discredit him. They wanted to stop him. And so his background and qualification as an apostle was brought into question. Was he really an apostle? And his teaching, it started to seem quite different to the teaching of the other apostles. So his teaching was brought into question. Is this true teaching from Paul and his life? Whether he practiced what he preached, that was brought into question. And so when we read Galatians, we're reading of a very crucial point in church history. Maybe the most important time in church history since Jesus. Jewish Christians were trying to take down Paul's mission to the nations of the world, the Gentiles. That's what Gentiles are, the nations. And Paul was God's chosen missionary to the world, to us. But his gospel seemed to be losing its Jewish flavor. And so the Jews wanted to stop Paul. They wanted to restrict Paul's gospel. They wanted to keep the gospel and their religion Jewish. And in chapter 2, verse 2, Paul shows how serious this is. He said he's afraid that he might be running his race in vain. And Paul isn't usually too afraid from what we know of him. But in this case, he's desperate. He's desperate to preserve the truth of the gospel. And so he needed to defend himself because the message was tied to him, the messenger. We see that he didn't really care too much about protecting his own life, but he had to defend himself because he knew that the gospel went with him and his mission to the world was under threat. And today we see Paul is still questioned and challenged to discredit Christianity. So his defense is important for us too as we read this letter. So we're going to see how Paul defends himself in today's passage, and he uses three different stories, three episodes, to talk about who he is and his qualifications as an apostle. We haven't done a Bible reading yet. We're going to do three Bible readings today. We're going to have three mini sermons, okay? Three for the price of one. But don't worry, they're a third of a normal length sermon, okay? So we're going to have three Bible readings. So Jatha's going to come and give them to us. The first episode, Paul defends his authority as an apostle. Was he true an apostle? Did he come late to the show? We know that the other 12 had 3 years with Jesus on earth. 3 years advantage, listening, watching, marveling at Jesus who was with them in the flesh, their friend who walked and ate and slept with them. Paul had none of that. Could he be an imposter? Well, let's read. So Jatha's going to read the first episode from Galatians 1, 10 to 24. Thanks, Jatha.
Galatians chapter 1, verses from 10. Am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the Church of God and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people and was extremely jealous of the traditions of my fathers. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being. I did not go up to Jerusalem to see those who are apostles, but I went to Arabia. Later, I returned to Damascus. Then, after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to get acquainted with Cephas and stayed with him 15 days. I saw none of the other apostles, only James, the Lord's brother. I assure you before God that what I am writing you is no lie. Then I went to Syria and Cilicia. I was personally unknown to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. Then only heard the report, the man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy, and they praise God because of me.
Throughout Paul's writing and in his letters in the New Testament, we see that Paul talks about this conversion story of his, and he uses it to teach people different lessons. So when he talks to Timothy, he uses his conversion to prove that God can save any sinner, as Paul saw himself as the worst of sinners. And when Paul wrote to the Corinthians, as we saw a few weeks ago in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul talks to them about his conversion and says he's qualified to preach on the resurrection because he saw the risen Lord Jesus. And in Galatians, Paul talks about his conversion, as we've just read. And what's he trying to prove as he talks about his conversion here? Well, I think he's talking about his conversion to show it's the work of God. And he introduces that idea well in verses 11 and 12. We just read verses 11 and 12. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. And Paul goes on to remind the Galatians of just what his old life looked like. How impossible it was in human terms to convert Paul. He was intensely persecuting the church of God, he says. Trying to destroy it was his aim. He was zealous beyond his age. Acts says he was breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. Can you imagine Paul joining the team of the disciples? It's ridiculous. There's only one explanation. Verse 15. God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me. Yes, there was a human side, as we saw on the video, a historical aspect of Paul's conversion, walking on the road one day, seeing a bright light, meeting Ananias, being baptized. But Paul doesn't emphasize any of these details in the story in Galatians. No, verse 15, it was God. God set Paul apart before he was born, according to his eternal plan. It wasn't a human decision, simply. In eternity past, God chose Paul. And God called him by grace. We talked about this grace last week. When you get a call from God and see how generous he is, giving his own son, it's too good to refuse that call. And God was pleased to reveal his son in Paul. See, he doesn't just say, Paul saw Jesus, that Jesus was revealed to Paul before his eyes. In Galatians, he said the son was revealed in me. Internal to Paul, Jesus appeared close to his heart, changing his heart, transforming this sinner. Jesus was revealed in Paul. See, Paul's conversion was an act of God. It was humanly impossible for man to convert Paul, and yet it was also humanly impossible for Paul to resist God's conversion of him. What a turnaround. And in the rest of this account, at the end of chapter 1, Paul just keeps emphasizing how it wasn't from man. He kept his distance from the other apostles. My immediate response, he says, was not to consult any human being. I didn't go up to Jerusalem to see the other apostles before I was. But I went into Arabia. Later, I returned to Damascus. See, the revelation when Jesus appeared to Paul wasn't, now go and see the other apostles and get the rest of the information. No, he didn't consult with any human, he says. He didn't go down to Jerusalem. He went out to Arabia and Damascus, and we know he started preaching the gospel there. See, if you wanted to call yourself an apostle, to claim that you were one of the Jesus' crew, I think you'd be going down to Jerusalem in a flash. You'd be booking an appointment with Peter, the chief of the apostles. But Paul says it was a whole 3 years before he went and saw any of the apostles. And he emphasizes it was only 15 days, 3 years, before he went to the apostles. 15 days he spent with Cephas, and Cephas is another name for Peter. 15 days he spent with Peter and didn't see any of the others except James for a moment. Verse 23 says he was personally unknown still to the churches of Judea. That's the churches down near Jerusalem. He hadn't been anywhere near Jerusalem, the headquarters of the Christian faith. Verse 24, in those churches that only heard the report, the man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy. And they praised God because of me. See, those Christians in Judea praised God because of Paul. Why? Because only God could bring about this change. The man who formerly persecuted us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy. Was Paul an authorized apostle? Yes. His commissioning and conversion were clearly from God, not from man. That's our first sermon finished. Paul was approved as an apostle by God. Second episode, chapter 2, verse 1 to 10. Paul uses another encounter to defend his teaching of the gospel. Yes, Paul was sent by God, we've seen, but did his teaching remain pure and true? As time went on, the evidence seemed to suggest that he was branching out to a different kind of gospel. See, we have a map. Paul was getting further and further away from Jerusalem. We have a map, I think. See those rings? Paul was getting further out from Jerusalem, which is in the bottom right. And the further he went, the less number of Jews were in the churches that he was preaching to. And many people from the nations, the Gentiles, were converting and joining the Jesus movement. And as this happened, it became more apparent to everyone that Paul's teaching was producing churches that looked a bit different to the Jewish churches in Judea. They had very different practices compared to those churches close to Jerusalem that were filled with Jewish Christians. So physical and practical markers, the markers of the people of God, were being neglected in these new churches. Things like circumcision and religious festivals and food laws. The proud identity of the people of God coming from the Old Testament law was being diluted by Paul's teaching. Was Paul's teaching pure? Was it the true gospel from God that Paul was teaching? Let's read the next episode. Three Bible readings keeps the Bible reader awake. That's good. Second Bible reading, chapter 2, verse 1 to 10.
Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. I took Titus along also. I went to respond to a revelation and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders. I pretended to them the gospel that I preached among the Gentiles. I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. And not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. We did not give to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. As for those who were held in high esteem, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God doesn't show favoritism. They added nothing to my message. On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised. Just as Peter had been to be circumcised, for God who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas that right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along.
14 years later now, after 3 years of after Paul's conversion, he went to Jerusalem once for a couple of weeks. Now it's 14 years later, he's been off again into the Gentile world preaching the gospel. 14 years later, and at first it sounds like Paul is starting to feel unsure about the gospel. He's been getting further and further away from Jerusalem. Then he gets this revelation, a message from God to go back to Jerusalem, to check in there with the head office. And Paul says he wants to be sure he isn't running his race in vain. And so he goes to the pillars of the faith, Cephas, who is Peter, James, and John, the apostles in Jerusalem. Some people are calling Paul's gospel into question. And now is Paul starting to doubt his own message? Well, no, Paul is not doubting his message. He's doubting the gospel that is coming out of Jerusalem. He goes back to check on them. Verse 4. This matter arose because some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. See, Paul was starting to hear this wave of false teaching following after him into the Gentile world. There was this teaching that new Gentile believers had to start following the Jewish law in order to be considered a part of God's people. Jewish Christians were going round to the Gentile churches, telling them to get circumcised or you're not a Christian. Paul knew this wasn't the true gospel. We saw it last week. Last week, the true and only gospel is Christ's gospel of grace, his gift. You need to do nothing other than accept it. We can't add to it. We can't contribute works to our salvation. To think that we could perfect
the gift of Christ himself is ridiculous and offensive. God's Son perfectly kept the law for us. He died in our place because none of us have kept it. So if you want to go back to keeping the law to save yourself, you're bringing yourself under God's judgment because we've all failed to keep the law. So Paul was going back to Jerusalem not to check his own gospel, but to check their gospel, that it wasn't overriding this gospel of grace that was for the whole world. And so Paul took Titus with him. Greek Titus, Gentile Titus, uncircumcised Titus. And Titus came with Paul as a guinea pig. Titus was his test case for the Christians in Jerusalem. Would Peter and James and John want Titus to be circumcised? Would they insist that Titus needed to keep the Jewish law to be included as a Christian? Poor old Titus. His foreskin becomes the focus of one of the great controversies in church history. Soon enough, Paul and Titus come into Jerusalem. The agitators appear, these false teachers, and there is pressure to circumcise Titus. Paul says, "We didn't give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you." Of course, Paul knew that circumcision is neither here nor there. It doesn't matter. Timothy, after he became Christian, was circumcised. Circumcised and uncircumcised can be equally saved by Jesus. But when people insist you must do something to be saved, they're adding works to the gift. They're perverting the gospel of grace. And Paul, in this case, had to resist. And he says his pure gospel was endorsed by the apostles. They passed the test. They agreed. Peter, James, and John agreed. Verse 6, they had nothing to add to my message, Paul says. Verse 3, not even Titus was compelled to be circumcised. Verse 9, James, Cephas, that is Peter, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed we should go to the Gentiles. See, Paul's gospel of the free grace of Jesus was the same gospel of Christ for the Jews. Our second episode shows that Paul's teaching was pure, the pure gospel, in agreement with the apostles at headquarters in Jerusalem. We move to our third episode. Perhaps the greatest test for Paul, his life. The greatest test maybe for any Christian leader? Did his life align with the message that he preached? See, true belief always leads to action. If you believe something to be true, you act on that belief. Otherwise, your actions reveal you don't really believe it. If you read a weather report that says it's going to rain today, if you believe the report, you won't hang out your washing. If you hang out your washing, you show you didn't believe the report. For Christian leaders, this is so important. The life of the leader becomes the lived example of his teaching. So leaders are to watch their life and doctrine closely, because how they live represents the gospel they teach. And perhaps the most powerful testimony to go with the words of the gospel is the teaching of a life lived to match what is spoken. Very sadly, there are many examples of Christian leaders who have sinned terribly and caused their message to lose its credibility to those they have spoken. And people lose their faith when leaders fall. There are many big cases of this. You might have seen some in the news, but also smaller cases. It's very hard to trust a leader when you discover that their life doesn't match their teaching. Of course, leaders fall, keep sinning, but it's the pattern of life. When there's a pattern of life that doesn't line with the teaching, can what he says really be true? Jesus' harshest and most angry criticism was for leaders who said one thing and did another, the Pharisees, who led so many people astray. What about Paul's life? Did his life match his teaching? Well, in our final episode, it's the shortest one. This is an occasion in Antioch this time, which is sort of the hub, the home church of the mission to the nations. And in this story, the apostle Peter slips up in his life. But what would the apostle Paul do? Let's have a look. We'll read our last passage, Galatians 2, 11 to 14.
When Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles, but when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles, because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of them all, "You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs?"
We know from the second episode that Peter and Paul had agreed that their teaching, their gospel, was the same, that there is nothing to be added, no obedience to the law that's required for salvation. And so when Peter comes up to visit this church in Antioch, he eats freely with the Gentiles, even non-kosher foods that the Jewish law prohibited: ham sandwiches, shellfish, bacon and eggs. But when they, certain Jewish men, arrived in Antioch, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. Peter suddenly stops eating with the Gentiles, excluding them from his fellowship. Immediately, Paul can see that Peter is not acting in line with the truth of the gospel. The free gospel says all are included by Christ's blood, apart from works of the law. In terms of salvation, it doesn't matter what we eat. So God's people can all eat together. Peter knew this was true, but because of his fear of men, this circumcision group, the Jewish Christians who wanted to enforce their law, Peter's actions were saying something different. He was giving the impression that the Jewish food laws still needed to be kept to stay together with God's people. His actions were teaching something different to his words. His actions were compelling Jewish and Gentile Christians to eat according to Jewish food laws in order to stay in the group. And Paul names it what it is, hypocrisy. Verse 13. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. See, we see others being led astray by Peter's life, his actions, which didn't match the truth that he claimed to teach, the truth of the gospel. You can imagine this must have been a very challenging moment for Paul. What would he do? Would his action now align with his teaching? Did Paul really believe that the gospel, the pure gospel of Christ, is everything? That the true gospel is the difference between heaven and hell? That trying to work for our salvation puts you under God's curse? If he believed this, he had to say something. If Paul didn't step up and say something, his actions would teach that he didn't really believe the true gospel was all that important. But remember, this is Peter we're talking about. Peter is the one that Paul has to stand up to, the greatest pillar of the church, the head honcho. Peter, to whom Jesus said, "On this rock I will build my church." Confronting Peter publicly would be awkward. It would be damaging. It would not be positive news for the papers. They would love this controversy. People would twist the story. People would inevitably divide. But Paul believed what he taught, and so he acted. Verse 11. When Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. And verse 14, when I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of them all, "You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs?" Paul spoke up. He opposed Peter publicly to his face. Paul spoke to preserve the truth of the gospel. Paul's life demonstrated, exemplified his teaching. His life, along with his words, proclaimed the gospel. Paul proved himself authentic. What great stories these are that we have in the letter to the Galatians, stories of Paul's history. Stories that Paul tells to show his authenticity. A true apostle called by God, teaching the true gospel of Christ, free grace to all who believe, not who follow the law. And his life, his actions matched his teaching. Paul was an amazing and wonderful apostle of God. And he's our apostle, apostle to the nations. The gospel has come to us through Paul's work and through his mission. So we stand by Paul. We listen to his words and we follow them as he teaches the gospel of Christ. So let's pray. Let's pray. Thank God for these episodes and thank God for Paul and his ministry. Let's pray. Our great God, we thank and praise you for our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the free grace, your generous gift in your Son, your perfect Son who lived the perfect life according to your law and who died undeserving, but died in our place to save us. We thank you for this tremendous gift. When we see it and understand it, we can't resist it. We thank you for your work, your calling to us through your Son. And we thank you, Father, so much for the Apostle Paul. We thank you for his tremendous turnaround, his testimony that we see is only from you. It could only be your work to change this life. We thank you for that powerful story, and we thank you for the wonder of Paul's mission and his work, how he stood up and proclaimed the true gospel to the nations. We thank you for the book of Acts and all that we read of his mission and his work, and we thank you that the gospel spread. The gospel spread with Paul and others to the end of the earth. We thank you that the gospel to the nations has reached us here, all these years later, the true gospel. And so we pray for us, please help us to know this gospel. Please help us to listen to your messenger, Paul. Please help us to follow the gospel of grace and give our lives in following Jesus. And we pray that this true and pure gospel would continue to spread through us to those around us, bringing the great news of salvation. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.